Hi guys, scared to meet the cat? It's lurking just round the corner. Don't be, you should be pretty sorted by now. And if you're not, let's look at a few things which you could get more sorted on. One particular aspect that people like to ignore, but they shouldn't, is reading comprehension. In fact, when I talk about reading comprehension, I like to introduce an anecdote from the Ramayana. When Angad had gone to Lanka to try and intercede and try and drill some sense into Ravan, he had tried to show people the importance of Lord Ram and his power, which extended even to his messengers. So he stood there with his feet firmly planted on the ground, and he invited people to move his foot. People tried. No one succeeded. And then, completely cheesed off, Ravan himself tried to shift Angad's foot. When Ravan bent down, you know what Angad said? He said, "Hamare pair chhune se kya hoga? Hamare pairos pe jhukne se kya hoga? Prabhu Ram Chandra ki sharan mein jao." So ladies and gentlemen, in our case, for CAT preparation, verbal section, Lord Ramchandra is, got that? Got it really? Please keep it, hang on to it. That's the magic mantra. Let's look at what happened last year. Last year's strengths, 30 questions in this particular section, of which 10 were logical reasoning. Logical reasoning as the non-verbal part of logical reasoning, and 20 were verbal. Of these 20, 9 were RC. Question to you. Can you ignore RC? Do you actually feel that evading RC will help you crack the cat? Perish the thought. Get real. It is this which is going to clinch the deal. Let's look at where you stand. Where you stand. How do you start a verbal section? If you keep reading comprehension for the end, each time in your mocks, in your simulated tests, then I doubt if you reach even a 50% accuracy. See, let's get this right. Some of you may. Some people actually function very good, very well under pressure. They feel that when they know that, oh God, now it's going to, the time's going to be up. So their adrenaline rises and they perform very well. But believe me, those are few, far between. Most people tend to panic when they look at the passage and they say, oh, 3 questions, 3 quarters of a page to read. It's not going to happen, and guess what? It doesn't. So let's first decide, how do you approach RC? RC in any case depends entirely upon, let's separate the two, reading. And reading is what is going to take you forward in all of whatever you're going to do. If you're not comfortable reading, how are you going to fare in the other sections? Get my point? So if you have been reading, even a bit every day, in fact, let's decide. Let's connect these two, where you stand and what you need to do. Read half an hour, at least, minimum. Okay? Minimum half an hour. My suggestion, editorial, The Hindu, and or opinion editorial, Economic Times. Right? I repeat, read for half an hour the editorial of the Hindu and of the opinion editorial of the Economic Times. That helps, but it has to be every day. If you haven't been doing it, please start now. It will really help you to get into the groove. With that, आरती पैसेज डेली. इन केस यू मिस दैट आई रिपीट, वन आरती पैसेज डेली. And you stop there, solve it, check your question, and okay, that's it. Oh my god, I've done so badly. Don't stop there, please. Check your answers, look at the explanatories, and see where do you go wrong each time, which is what I'm going to take up in even more detail later. Let's try a passage, right? Just one passage, come on, don't moan and groan. We have it. Download it and let's look at the questions together. Come. What are the challenges that you face? What are the challenges that you face in reading comprehension? True confessions. Unfamiliarity in several areas. The activity itself. We had agreed that reading is the base and reading is not a familiar activity for you. Unless you of course have to, unless you've taken to it kicking and screaming. So the reading comprehension, when you approach it, it's the whole aspect of reading which stresses you out, which hopefully by now it shouldn't be. So hopefully, I am an optimist, the activity should no longer be an unfamiliar activity. This would probably remain the subject area. For instance, this particular passage is on art. And I don't know when was the last time you read about art. In fact, maybe you never read about art. So the unfamiliarity of the subject area will of course remain. That doesn't change. Here my question to you is, think of the answer. We'll arrive at the answer together. Is it better to have a familiar area from which the reading comprehension passage has been drawn, or is it better to have an unfamiliar area? Think. There may not really be any cut or dried answer, but surprisingly, the unfamiliar area should not be a challenge. Guys, what is reading comprehension? It is what every student probably dreams of. It's an open book exam. All that you need to answer the questions is available. It's right there with you. You have it, you read it, and then you answer the questions. And if you're getting confused, you go back to the text. So what could get better than that? Please, deal with this. Even if the subject area is an unfamiliar area, it doesn't matter, provided you become comfortable with the activity of provided you're comfortable with reading. That's fair. Now let's look at this, the style in which the author writes. That could be challenging. It could be convoluted, long sentences. In fact, by the time you reach the end of the sentence, you've forgotten what it began with. But let's get this too. Ultimately, the author is trying to say something. So while we feel that it's really, really dark and it's really challenging and everything's abstruse, it may not be. Break up the sentence. Don't read the whole length of the sentence. Read a few words, stop, wherever you feel the idea is changing. Look at the notepad that you have, just put down that one word, okay, and then proceed. You'll be surprised that when you look at those words, it ends up making a lot of sense. Incidentally, here I am going to say something which I will stress upon in greater detail maybe later, otherwise you'll catch it right now. Many of you feel that reading comprehension passages and attempting reading comprehension is, you're putting in a lot of time. Guys, let's talk about ROI, return on investment. Consider, I do not decry any part of verbal, I can't, not me. But consider a parajumble. A parajumble in which the sentences are 3 lines each. So you count
5 sentences, 3 lines each. What does that get you to? 15 sentences, which is almost like, say, half a page. And what are you dealing with? You're dealing with a single question. Whereas, in reading comprehension, with the computer-based avatar that Kat has gone into, your passages are not all that lengthy. Max is 3/4 of a page. 3/4 of a page, you read that, it's reading around the same idea and you access 3 questions. Get me? So please don't allow the style to be a challenge. It doesn't matter. Really it doesn't. Now let's come to vocabulary. Guys, if they're writing about say some economic crisis, the words used will be on the economic crisis. It will be topical, it will be contextual. And hello, you're MBA hopefuls, right? So by now you should be comfortable reading the Economic Times. It should not be a challenge. But jokes apart, even if you come across a really difficult word, don't allow it to stress you out because it's in context. You know, even if you're, you probably won't be asked the meaning of that word. And if you are, because it figures in context, when you look at the options, you're generally able to figure it out. So all these challenges that we've put down are not insurmountable. By now, you should have learned to circumvent them. I hope you have. Let's now talk about the questions. Okay, let's say not the question, the questions. The questions. And how do we approach them? Should we look at questions first or the passage first? The options are another challenge. Let's just talk about this. The type of questions, you know, guys, in the good old days when verbal was a 50 mark section and there were at least 3 passages which may have had 5 or 6 questions each, we told our students, look for the specific idea question first and try and go back to the passage. Find the answer, and then if you're comfortable, you could try attempting the main idea question. Now, unfortunately, or maybe even fortunately, we don't have that kind of luxury because passages are shorter, questions are limited, and you really don't know what you can leave out. But how you approach it will definitely help you to improve your scores. That is what we talk about. Take some time, go through this, go through the passage, and then let's talk about each question. The classic dilemma of the cat taker when it comes to reading comprehension. I've had this question posed to me n number of times. Ma'am, questions first or passage first? When we kickstart our preparation, I always say, guys, read the passage first. You can't run the marathon without training, can you? So read the passage first. Now, when we're standing facing the firing squad, strategies change. If you have done sufficient preparation, if you have been through a lot of reading comprehension passages and have analyzed, you should be ready. So to those of you, in fact, I would say now to all of you, since we are addressing this to those who are just about to take the CAT, let's look at questions first. Now, this particular passage that you're dealing with has 4 questions. I would like you to read only the question. I repeat, only the question. Do not look at the options. The first question, the main purpose of the passage. The second, the 19th century scientists believe that the theory of evolution. Which of the following would the author agree? And according to the author, many misunderstandings have been caused by the belief that. Look at question number 2. It's something specific. Go back to the passage, try and find these words. Found them?
read around that and see if you can answer the given question. Look at the last question. That too is pretty specific. Many misunderstandings have been caused by the belief that. See if there is any reference to any misunderstanding or any word which is close to the word misunderstanding. Also appreciate, please, that it is a short passage. When you try to find the answer to question number 2 and to question number 4, you will necessarily have gone through, skimmed through the given passage. And now you are in a position to look at the general questions, the central idea or the general questions based on this passage, which would be the first and the third. See, the third has no other lead. All it says is, with which of the following would the author agree? You can't answer this question unless you have read the passage. Are you getting my point? If you have approached second and fourth correctly, you will have gone through the passage. After having done so, you are now in a position to attempt question number 1 and question number 3. I will also give you a checklist on what to consider when you look at main idea questions. Let's do that right away. I'm erasing this, guys. I hope you work. I'm erasing the challenges and the unfamiliarity bit, okay? I'm keeping the rest because we'll be touching upon this a bit later. I hope you are familiar with this word. If you're not, then you've got problems. This is indeed the magic mantra of multiple choice questions. So in an aptitude test where you're dealing with multiple choice questions, proceed by eliminating. You may not be able to make a beeline for the right answer, but you can in due course arrive at the right answer having evaluated and rejected the wrong options. Get me? We're going to discuss this for main idea questions. The main idea question, as you know, may also figure as central idea. It may also figure as the theme. The question may also be worded as the passage is about. Right? By now you should be familiar with how a main idea question is worded. And now I want you to be very clear on how you proceed to eliminate when you attempt a main idea question. Please pray to the good Lord that at least one option is a contradiction. Right? So that's what you eliminate first. Obvious, isn't it? If we're looking for the main idea of a particular passage, then the contradiction will immediately have to be eliminated. What is the next thing? We're looking at the main idea. So we are looking for a sort of summary. Please consider this. If the passage talks about A, B, C, D, and you have an option which says A, B, B. C is missing. But we're in a hurry, right? We've been told there's this time pressure and you get approximately 2.5 minutes per question. So you're in a hurry. And A, B, D seems pretty good. You end up marking A, B, D. But what have you marked? You have marked the incomplete or the partial answer. Unacceptable. It is not conveying in full measure what the main idea of the passage is. So that has to be eliminated. After contradiction, what do you try and look for and what do you eliminate? you eliminate the incomplete or the partial answer. Get me? Consider A, B, C, D, all of it, and then some more. The passage talks about A, B, C, D. Your answer gives you, your option, I'm sorry, gives you A, B, C, D, plus plus. Tempting. It has everything and some more. We Indians always like a bit more. Right? The big fat Indian wedding. So you mark that as your answer. That particular option becomes your answer. It shouldn't. It should be eliminated. One more. The example, a particular reference or illustration. Guys, get this. An example is meant to take forward an idea. Can an example replace the idea? Think. If it's very, it's really well given, very prominently given, very attractively packaged, it could tempt you, but it shouldn't. Please remember, the example, the reference, the illustration is to take forward, to carry forward an idea. It cannot replace the idea. It cannot completely overpower the idea. So that is the other thing which you need to look for and eliminate, and often it is there. This is the classic dilemma. The general option. This passage, for instance, is about art. Oh, is it about art or is it about primitive art? Answer. If you answered primitive art, then I'm sorry. You need to read it again. It's about art. In the sense, it's drawn from art. It's about a specific aspect. It's talking about how it is so unfair to refer to any art as primitive art because art is art. So, what's the main idea? It's not art. That's the general area from which it has been drawn. The main idea is that it is wrong to club, it is wrong to brand any art as primitive art because art is art. So if your answer takes you towards the general, then I'm afraid you have not learnt the process of elimination for the main idea question. Quick recap. This is what you look at, this is what you eliminate. The contradiction, the incomplete idea, the example or the reference or the general. In fact, anything which misrepresents. The main idea should necessarily encapsulate what the passage is talking about. If it does that in the given option, that's the answer you're looking for. Right? One more thing I want you to always remember is the questions are all from the same passage. So please don't view questions in isolation. Please view them in the interconnectivity which is necessary because they're all dealing with the same passage. Consider question 1 of this passage and question 3 of this passage. If we figured the answer for question number 1, incidentally let me give you the answer and also tell you why it is the answer. The answer to question number 1 is not option 1. Option number 1 is a partial answer. It talks only about primitive and it doesn't talk about art. And after you've gone through the passage, you realize that it is most definitely not about the definitions of the term primitive. They've been linked to something else. Consider 2. Remember, what did we agreed to eliminate first? The contradiction. It's contradicting it. If you were able to reject 2, then you should have immediately got the correct answer, which is option 4. Because if you were tempted by 5, I'm not even considering option 3. If you were tempted by 5, then you're caught in a trap. It seems to be praising primitive arts. But remember, the author denies that there is any such thing as primitive art. So even if you're praising, you're acknowledging, which defeats the purpose. I hope you got the answer, which is option 4. If you got this answer correct, let us skip question number 2 and let us move on to question number 3. If deprecate the use of the term primitive is applied to art, is the main purpose of the passage, then with which of the following would the author agree? I hope you were able to reject 3 and 1. 4 is a reference which brings us to another idea. And 5 again was the one among the ones which you should have rejected first. I repeat, if you understood question number 1, then option 2 is the answer for question 3 should have hit you on the face. Now let's look at question number 2. This is a direct question. Go back to that area and read. Look at these lines particularly. These students saw all cultures as stages in a single line of development and assigned them to places in this series on the simple basis of the degree to which they differed from European culture. So, theory of evolution, elated by the newly enunciated doctrines of evolution, these students, etc. So, this answer should hit you on the face. Option number 1. And question number 4. This again is direct. This idea has long since been abandoned, etc., etc. It still tinges a great deal of the thought and writing about the arts of non-European peoples and has been responsible for many misunderstandings. Option 4. Because this takes us back to the last bit of this passage, which began with elated, etc., etc. The ultimate thing was considered to be European culture, the final star. And though this theory has been rejected, it has been the cause of many misunderstandings. Guys, I'd like to recap all that we have done so far. Let's start with the importance of reading comprehension. Consider it to be the base of everything that you do for an aptitude test. It's going to be your skill, your enhanced skill with reading, which is going to help you to perform better in the quant and in the DI sections. Because guys, unless you understand a question, how can you proceed to address it? That's fair, is it not? So reading is the base. Get comfortable with reading. As I had said earlier, half an hour of reading every day plus one RC passage plus analyzing that RC passage. Being comfortable with the idea that reading should now become a familiar activity for you so that the challenges of the reading comprehension section get reduced. Do not allow the vocabulary to stress you out, because it's always contextual. It's not a word in isolation, which is very difficult to figure out. It is a word in context which conveys an idea, so much easier to figure out. It's a question that I've faced I don't know how many times. Ma'am, there's hardly any difference in these two options. But that's what makes all the difference. It could be something as basic as the use of the word and the. Imagine. But that is what it's all about. The options have to be close. You'll rarely come across questions where the answer hits you on the face. It probably may in specific idea questions, and you should be able to read around it and get the answer. But often the options are very close. And let me tell you, where do people get stuck? Remember I had said that this is the option which you have to eliminate in the context of a main idea question. In most questions in reading comprehension, people get stuck between the general and the particular option. I am sure many people are nodding in agreement. That happens very frequently. Be aware of this, please. And when you do come to these two options, understand the question that is being asked to you is on the basis of the passage that you're dealing with. So the answer can only be the particular option and not the general option. At the cost of repeating myself, we had agreed that we are now going to look at questions first. You should now be comfortable with this way of dealing with RC passages. Look at the questions. Unfortunately, the number of questions is pretty limited now. So out of three questions, you may have one specific idea question. You look at it, go back to the passage, try and find it, and you will find that in looking for it, you have already skimmed through part of the passage. So that should put you in a position where you can attempt the main idea question too. If you're lucky enough to have something given to you in, say, inverted commas, this particular phrase used in paragraph number 2 means, I mean, let's pray for such a question, okay? So you just go back to that and you read it, and that's your answer. And in the bargain, you have read around it. So an inferential question or a main idea question should be comfortable. Inferential question reminds me, this is to wind up, okay? What is an inference? An inference is something you arrive at after having received some data. For inferential questions too, you can make a checklist on how you have to proceed. And there are bound to be inferential questions. Since the number of questions have been reduced, you probably have a inferential question, if not all the passages and all three, at least in one or two. Remember please that whatever is directly stated cannot be the answer to an inferential question. It has to be implicit, not explicit. Also, since an inference is derived from the data given, it cannot be a contradiction. Hang on to that. An inference question cannot be explicit. An inference question cannot contradict data given. I think that about covers it up. Reading comprehension, good return on investment. In fact, it's going to be your lifeline. Do give it a lot of attention. And even these last few days, if you try and use all that we've discussed here, I think you can improve your scores. All the best to you. Go and bell the cat.